7:15. And that clock is 5 minutes slow. So I may truncate what I say. In my 30s, I felt a deep emptiness in me. And I was extremely successful as a marriage and family therapist. I had a newborn son, and I had a wonderful husband, good marriage. And so when I felt that deep emptiness, I decided that it must be spiritual. And I had heard so much about meditation, the things that people were talking about then, an alternative spiritual kind of experience. And so I decided to meditate with a group. And because it was a spiritual development class, I joined it because it had spiritual in the title, right? But it was at a spiritualist church. And I meditated with this group of people for 7.5 years. And when I tried to get out of spiritualism and psychic work and channeling and all that went with it, I became demonized, completely possessed, and it happened overnight like that. And what happened was I found myself face to face with pure evil. Now, I'm not going to go into my testimony about all of that, because what I really want to focus on is that when Christ saved me, it happened in a second. And he came in with his spirit, and he broke the hold that the demons had on my life. And in that same time, simultaneously, he told me that his word was the Bible, the Holy Bible, and that I was to give his word authority over my thoughts. And because everything within me was chaotic and evil, pure evil, I had nothing else to trust but the Bible. I had faced the enemy without the Holy Spirit and God, and I knew him to be pure evil, mean, random attacks, confusing thoughts, terrible, lustful, vengeful, rageful emotions. Everything that I hated. And I had learned when I was possessed to step back and be like on a shelf within me, as if I was an audience to my inner life. And so I knew how to dissociate. So when the Spirit of God came in, I knew to join him. I already knew my thoughts made no sense. So the only thing that made sense to me was Christ. And when God told me in that second that the Bible was his word, I believed him. And I took it literally. Now, I know that when people are possessed in the Bible that, you know, instantly they're healed. That wasn't my experience. It was a long walk out. But I walked out by replacing my thoughts with scripture. And the moment I was saved, or I would say the day I was saved, I went home and I printed 2 scriptures. Therefore, now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I had no idea why that was true, but since it came from God, I believed it. And because I was constantly being assaulted with what a terrible, despicable person I was, I believed this. The second one was, for God does not give us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and of self-control. I believed him. I was always afraid. Of course, I was being tyrannized. But I believed God. And so I chose to believe him. Now, I know that the warfare metaphor is very prevalent in Christian culture. And I think in one aspect, it's excellent. Because the intensity of the battle is so like being on the front lines in war. And so I identified with that part of the warfare. The part of it that is not captured in that metaphor is that Christ defeated Satan at the cross, and that he gave us fellowship with God through faith in Jesus Christ, so that when we cling to him, as he was telling me to do through his word, through his spirit, I knew that he already had won. Now, I could not have described theologically why all of that was true. I just knew that he was the superior force in the universe, and I wanted to be close to him, which I was, because I felt it. In my inner being, I felt it. And yet, you know what it's like to be in a war. It's intense, and yet, when God brought me into fellowship with him, the enemy was already defeated, as we have talked about. He was defeated, and yet I had to learn how to resist the enemy. And so at first, because I didn't understand theologically anything about the atonement, I mean, honestly, I just thought I was basically a good person, that I got into trouble, I made a few mistakes, and that I got into the wrong camp spiritually. But now that I was in the right camp, I thought he was just going to leave me out, and I was going to go back to that person I was before. Because, of course, I didn't realize the depth of my sin. But I did realize who the enemy was, and I did realize who Jesus Christ was and what he did for me at the cross. The part of this teaching that I really want to get across is that there is a juncture in all of our lives when we have to ask ourselves, who do you believe? Because you're overwhelmed with a certain feeling, a certain thought that's so powerful, seems so right. And yet you have to ask yourself, do I believe this, or do I believe the word of God that aligns with my spirit, who is Christ? Right? Now, I actually was blessed by the fact that there was nothing left of me. I had been gutted. And so all I had was Christ and his word. So I clung to that. And I had already learned to dissociate from my entire being. And so that when I had the word of God and I would join Christ in my battle, for me, it was like, oh my gosh, this is freedom. This is wonderful. And then God slowly healed me inside as he changed me from the inside out, so that when I read something like, how great is the love that God has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, 3 years later, I knew what that felt like inside. But it took a long time and a long walk out. But I can say this, that there's still parts of me that I don't submit now that I've gotten stronger. I was in a therapist at the time after I got saved. I converted my practice to a Christian practice. And I had this young woman come who was in a marriage that she wanted out of, desperately out of. She said her husband was boring. And
is that biblical?
She didn't like him. He watched television, and that he would turn her off when he was talking. And so she really, really wanted to leave him, and she was Christian. And just as a side comment, she said to me that not long ago she had broken her leg and had gone in and someone had put a cast on her leg, doctor. And then that night she'd gone to a healing service at her church and someone had laid hands on her leg and it had been completely healed. So she went back to her doctor and of course said this, and they took another x-ray and sure enough, her leg was completely healed. And as I was listening to this, and I knew his power in my life, I was thinking, oh my gosh, This woman just had her leg healed. Doesn't she think that God can heal her marriage? No. She didn't want to. She just didn't want to, you know. And I wouldn't even say that to her. I say, you know, God can heal your heart and heal your marriage. And she didn't believe me. He could heal your leg. So that it was almost like God was in this air, you know, I had a specialty in legs. But he didn't in hearts. He was It's hard to hold in tension, this tension between the facts on the ground and God's promises and God's word. It's hard to hold those two things in tension and to make the choice to believe what you're going to believe. Now, has anyone ever heard of James Stockton? He was a philosopher, and I'm not sure he was a Christian, but this is a good quote, and I thought it applied. You must never confuse faith that you will prevail in the end, which you can never afford to lose, with a discipline to confront the most brutal facts of your current reality, whatever they might be. And Jim Stockton was held for 7 years in the Hanoi Hilton during the Vietnam War. So he was 7 years severely tortured because he was a commander. So he was with McCain. You must never confuse faith that you will prevail in the end, which you can never afford to lose, with the discipline to confront the most brutal facts of your current reality. I think on the outside, people might say to us that Christians are in la-la land, you know. They have all this faith and but it's not true, is it? We see what's going on. And I think God wants us to see what's going on as we choose to believe in his word and in his promises and the spirit which he has given us, especially as we gather together as sisters in the body of Christ, that we are truly in Christ, and yet we see the world that we live in. Even situations in our family, we see situations in the world that we are saved, and we know who we put our trust in, and we look clearly at the evil around us. So we say 1 John 3:1, we put on the divine armor, and we say these words: see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. And in Romans 8, knowing all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height or depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Philippians 4:13, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. And 2 Corinthians, and this is for those of us who say, Jesus, would you please heal this? And sometimes he says, no. For my grace is sufficient, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecution, calamity. For then I am weak, but then I am strong. This is how he replaces lies with his truth. When we choose what to believe, do we believe our experiences? Do we believe the word of God and the spirit within us? Praise be to God.